When a $3 trillion AI company says jump, everyone says how high. Since we first started covering NVIDIA 9 years ago, they've gone from selling gaming cards to being one of the most popular stocks out there. So when NVIDIA invested in a little-known Netherlands company called Nebius, the market took notice. Now Nebius claims they can grow revenues by over 600% in a year. Is this little-known stock ready to show us some explosive AI growth, or is this just another manifestation of AI hype? Today, we're going to help you better understand a little-known AI stock that's soon to be on everyone's radar. So this article here by Investors Business Daily brought about some of our premium subscribers to raise the name Nebius Group. The stock had jumped, it says here, after NVIDIA joins a $700 million investment. Now, there's a couple things to note here. First, that this is a private placement from a group of investors that includes NVIDIA. So what you have there is a valuation benchmark that you can compare the current stock price to. And second, we need some context around this NVIDIA investment. It's not good enough to just say NVIDIA invested. Since everyone wants to have NVIDIA as an investor, you could practically give them shares and they would take those shares, which would be insignificant, but then you'd be able to issue press releases. So just some basics about Nebius. So some of you might be familiar with Yandex. It's certainly an app that I've used traveling, and this is a firm that used to be considered the Google of Russia. Now, Russia, as you know, has had some issues, and Nebius then decided to spin out the non-Russian assets of Yandex, and that included four AI-focused businesses in cloud, data labeling, self-driving cars, and education technology to be developed under the Nebius name. You see here this article from Reuters talks about how the split was finalized this past summer. The Russian assets of Yandex were sold in a $5.4 billion deal. It's rather an interesting read. I won't bore you with the details, but the gentleman behind this spin-out here that you can see featured in this article by Der Spiegel talks about how Europe should be smart enough to use those people who fled Russia. Of course, he's mentioning himself there. He's the founder of Yandex, so he created a $30 billion company. Of course, it's not valued that much today, as you can see in the Reuters article, based on the valuation, the sum of the parts. But he exited Russia and then sold all the Russian assets off without getting himself killed. Quite the feat. He then created a new AI franchise in Europe called Nebius. Now, I think the Russian ties shouldn't be a concern anymore here. He has four companies to work with. We're going to talk about those today, and around $2.8 billion in cash, but that is now increased by $700 million. So a sizable war chest. They hired Goldman Sachs to raise that additional $700 million. And the latest funding round was oversubscribed. That means there was a lot of demand for it. And they issued shares at a price of $21 per share, which represented a 3% premium to the volume-weighted average price the shares had traded at since the resumption of trading on NASDAQ. Now, this is a valuation benchmark for retail investors. It's currently trading at $29 a share, so I don't know why you would pay an immediate 38% premium to what institutions paid. Now, this investment came from a select group of institutional and accredited investors, including, of course, participation from NVIDIA and Excel and other accounts managed by Orbis Investments. Now, we have zero context on the NVIDIA participation. In order to understand that better, we need to wait until February of next year. So NVIDIA is a partner of Nebius, and this is where things can get rather interesting. So Nebius is buying a ton of product from NVIDIA. So then NVIDIA buys shares from Nebius, and then Nebius just gives that money right back to them. And this is what sometimes qualifies as a related party transaction. So we really don't know the details here. And we're going to have to wait until NVIDIA files their 13F in February of next year that will detail just how many shares they purchased. We know the price they purchased them at, right? So then we can start to put that investment into context, as we always need to do. One thing to note here is the very aggressive revenue guidance that Nebius gives. So this was previously $500 to $700 million in revenues for next year. And a couple things to note here. First is that Last quarter, they had $43 million, and they expect this year to bring in $125 million at midpoint. So that implies a $46 million fourth quarter. So not very much quarter over quarter sequential growth there. But what's even more interesting is that after that $700 million round, they said, well, we actually expect next year to have between $750 million to $1 billion in revenue off that $125 million base. That's a massive jump. You can see on the right what that implies for the sort of quarterly revenue growth they'd have to see if it was evenly spread out. This is coming off last quarter revenues, as I said, of $43 million. So they expect 2025 revenue growth of 600% off a $125 million base. Is this a credible projection? Well, they say yes, because of their founder who was able to create a $30 billion business in Yandex and having a lot of experience building a cloud business from ground up and over $3 billion in cash. It really, though, sounds like you're betting more on a founder's ambitions than you are on an established company. So it feels more like investing in a startup. To be honest, it smells a little bit like a SPAC, but we wouldn't go that far because you had institutional investor participation. Now, the December 2023 20F, that's what foreign firms need to file, talked about the core retained businesses. Remember, we talked about four businesses they have, and there's, of course, Nebius AI. This is an AI cloud platform. They talk about being one of the largest providers of GPU capacity in Europe. Be careful there. We're going to touch on that. It's referring to a cutting-edge data center located in Finland. Then they have this Toloka AI, a data solutions partner for Gen AI and LLM development. Basically, data labeling is not very exciting, frankly. Triple tenant ed tech service, equally as lackluster from where we sit. And this AV Ride, they say one of the leading developers of self-driving technologies. Now, what you could then do is start to look into the roots of each of these businesses to understand where they came from, but we certainly aren't going to put in the time to do that, and I'll tell you why in a second. So, since 87% of the exponential forecasted growth is supposed to come from this Nebius segment, that's where we ought to be focused on most. And they describe this as a AI-centric, of course, cloud platform, building large, cost-efficient GPU clusters to service the explosive growth of the global AI industry. And of course, their investor deck has slide after slide after slide talking about the opportunity. We're more interested in learning about how they plan to execute against this very lofty goal. So you see here, I've highlighted this bit on the slide. It says, energy-efficient own data center in Finland. We'll talk about that. A co-location data center in Paris, okay, and further expansion plans. A lot of this is a story that you're investing in. And of course, they talk about their long-standing collaboration with NVIDIA. They expect to be receiving Blackwell servers that they're going to be, of course, offering through their data centers. And this Finnish data center is supposed to be something unique. Interesting comment here. They say, due to corporate restructuring, i.e. the Russia problem, the data center has not operated at full capacity since 2022. What they're doing here is just ramping that up again, right? Now, this data center has some unique characteristics. It employs free cooling. I like this term. Leveraging external ambient air to reduce air temperature in the data rooms. I'm leveraging external ambient air right now, except it's rather hot here where I'm at. They also talk about being one of the first in the region to introduce heat recovery tech to warm local homes. So there's this idea that because they build their own servers and because of this unique way they're building their data centers, that the data center power consumption and overall data center costs are 20% less. We know that cooling, what, makes up somewhere between 30 and 40% of a data center's cost. So certainly having a data center or servers that consume 20% electricity, you combine all that together, more efficient data centers is great. You're able to pass on those savings to the customer or not. Revenue segmentation, this is where we're going to look at these four businesses. And Nebius last quarter accounted for 2/3 of the group's total revenues. That makes sense when you consider that's going to be 87% of the growth potential. Then Toloka, second largest contributor to the group's total revenue. Now, this is based on a press release of unaudited financials. We'd like to see something more concrete in the form of an SEC filing that we can peruse, but we need to deal with what we have. They didn't provide additional detail there, but then we were able to cobble this all together when they say in Q3 2024, Triple 10, that's the ed tech piece, had $27.2 million in annualized recurring revenues, which they calculate as last month times 12. Well, typically that would be last quarter times 4, but we're given this number. So we can imply $6.8 million last quarter. Ergo, we get Nebius at $28.4 million, Toloka at $7.8, Triple 10 at $6.8. So what exactly do each of these segments do? Well, Toloka here, not very exciting stuff, frankly. They say they pivoted to a new business model in 2023, whereas prior they were working on data labeling and crowdsourcing. This really sounds like Appen. It's exactly what Appen has been doing. We used to be investors in Appen, but we exited that position when we realized that this whole data labeling thing is going the way of the dodo quite quickly, and Appen's tried to pivot. Toloka appears to be doing the same. They've been around for what? It seems to be operating as one of the world's largest open crowdsourcing platforms for over a decade now, and this is an Appen pivot from a company that's been around for a long time. It's not something we'd be interested in. And they talk about things like synthetic data. Well, synthetic data has been around for a very long time. We've been covering that for 8 years now. And it may even be creating problems for models. And when you consider the metrics we've talked about in previous presentations, such as the fact that AI has consumed a lot of the known data that exists right now, and the real money is in licensing data. We're now being approached by firms asking to license data in our own videos that we publish on YouTube, rather strange value propositions floating around out there as everybody desperately tries to get their hands on unique data. But is this data labeling platform really expected to roughly double revenues next year based on this pivot? Well, that's what they say. When companies start throwing up these very aggressive revenue targets, it seems rather suspicious, especially when they do the same thing for their EdTech business, Triple 10. They expect to roughly double revenue next year too, and they describe it as a leading EdTech platform in the United States. So it's training all the future talent of tomorrow that AI will soon displace. Not something we'd be overly interested in, especially when you look at this curious metric here. You see students grew by 3,700 heads or 60% last quarter, but then when you look at revenue growth last quarter, grew only by $400,000 or 1.5%. What's up with that? Perhaps there's a lagging revenue recognition, but it's hard to believe that they're going to build those revenues up 100%. So takeaways here, data labeling isn't overly compelling, nor is synthetic data, and EdTech, the same holds true for that thesis as well. Since both these ventures account for just 13% of expected growth, I didn't think there was much value in going down the rabbit hole to figure out where these businesses came from, what they were doing before, how they compete against their closest competitors, which is an obvious next step when you're evaluating a particular thesis. Now, the fourth segment is worth mentioning briefly, although it won't have revenues for several more years. That's the autonomous piece here, AV Ride. They say it's uniquely positioned in the industry by simultaneously developing autonomous driving tech for cars and delivery robots. And we can then skip the next 37 pages of greatness about all the things that they're accomplishing and look to what matters, as we always do, which is how much money do you need to get this thing to generate revenues? And not too much based on their war chest here. They say up to $150 million. They talk about also seeking external investment or co-investment. But this bit here, 2026 or beyond, they're expecting to generate double-digit million U.S. dollar revenues. So in other words, $10 million. So not a whole lot in the bigger picture if they hit those large growth aspirations. But just some comments here. While there's synergies across these businesses, and they'll try to spell that out, assuming that all three grow in the triple digits seems, I would say, somewhat unrealistic. So they expect Nebius to grow 600% and Toloka sees 100%, Triple 10, 100%. Focus should largely be on the Nebius AI segment. Ideally, we need to see these businesses broken out in future financials, especially when it comes to gross margins for each, so we can gauge profitability, which seems to be reasonable so far. But there's really no rush to invest here, especially at these extremely lofty valuations. I would wait until they have an SEC filing document for the new business. As I said, they have a 20F close to a year old. So wait until they have a new filing document to peruse that looks at this business post spinoff, not press releases based on unaudited financials. Nebius is interesting enough to keep an eye on, and I think we'll check back in a year to see if they've managed to hit those lofty growth aspirations. And then, of course, watch that NVIDIA 13F filing to see just how meaningful that investment was. And then, of course, take it with a grain of salt. Now, I wanted to leave you with an interesting video on Broadcom we did 6 months ago, and you would have seen Broadcom in the news lately based on the fact they might be the next NVIDIA. Will they? Well, you're going to have to watch this video to find out. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.